Still Cooper, he's trying to go all the way himself. And stumbling there, perhaps fatigue setting in after that long meandering run. Good play in this match from both sides. Thoroughly entertaining. Here's more from here. Duncan George! Oh, what a good save that was from Billy Thompson. Oh, another excellent attack from here. George Burley will be taking tremendous encouragement from the second half performance. Agnew playing it on. There's the head flick down from Graham. That's when he's so dangerous. Bryce setting it up here for George. He got away from his man. That's a good save. Burley now to Kennedy. They had a great chance again! And once again it's Duncan George who's out of luck, but what a fine second half performance this has been from here. Well, they were intended to throw in the towel at half time, they didn't do that, they came on, and here's Duncan George with a very good shooting chance. But the final whistle goes, Motherwell are safely through to the fourth round of the Scottish Cup. Well, they'll face Rangers, but Ali Graham scored a goal in the second half for United, which their performance in that period thoroughly merited. It really was a transformation on the part of Ayr after the interval. They were well dropped in the first half with a superb Motherwell performance, producing four good goals. Jamie Dolan certainly came close in the second half, but Ayr took all the honours in that second period. Motherwell finding it hard to step up the pace. But they're through safely. They'll be at Ibrox in round four. It's Motherwell four, United 1.
Tommy, it appeared to be a mixture of the good and the bad. Let's talk about the good first. How do you feel about that first half performance?
First half was absolutely magnificent. We got a lot of success with one touch play, especially from the left hand side of the park where we were getting beyond them and getting balls across them. And we got a lot of success from that. But in the second half, we could all have went home at half time. I know it's difficult for players to motivate themselves when it is 4-0. But the disappointing thing from our point of view is the thing that got us success in the first half was stopped. There was definitely never got beyond in the second half and never got balls across. We wanted to play in front of the opposition, and I honestly felt that certain players definitely wanted to make a name for themselves as individuals rather than as the first half it was collectively.
You did take some time after the game in the dressing room. Were you making these points to the players?
Well, the point really is that good teams persevere and keep doing the things that get them success, and we stop playing. It honestly tells me something about certain players in my team, that they're definitely playing within their well within their capabilities and no extending themselves.
It's a remarkable thing that we're talking here after a 4-1 cup victory to a manager who's not entirely happy with his team. Is that the case?
Well, I would have settled for 4-1 at any time. But what annoys me is really that within a half an hour, I think we get four goals, and then in the second half, we just don't play. I think the only time we got beyond was the time that the boy Arnott hit the post. But we just stopped doing the things that brought us success, and good teams persevere and keep doing things that get them success.
So you've made the point for the players for Saturday?
Look, you can only do so much. Basically, it's down to individuals. You know, I know it's difficult. I've been in that position before. But really, we haven't been a good goal-scoring team so far this season. We had the opportunity tonight to run up a good score, and we tossed it away.
Tommy, well done, nevertheless.
Thanks.
Derek, it's not the surprise of the night that Tommy McLean's critical of his team.
I tell you what to do, that first 45 minutes, send the tape to him, because he was delighted. That's the first time he's been happy for years, isn't it, wee Tam?
But do you see his argument?
Yes, I do, but it's very difficult. As he said, I've been in the same position as well. You're three or four goals up at half time. It is hard to motivate yourself because the game is won. There's no way the opposition are going to score five goals in the second half. And fair dues to Ayr United. They never gave in. They kept trying to come forward because they had to throw caution to the wind because they're out of the cup, really, at half time.
Some slick stuff from Motherwell in that half. Let's look at the three goals that came from open play. They were already one up at this stage.
Yeah, well, there is... They've struggled all season to put the ball in the back of the net, and before the game, wee Tam was saying, look, we need to be a wee bit more destructive up front. And there's a wee man, I love Dougie Arnott. He's a thorn in every defender's flesh. He's always there or thereabouts in the box. There was a wee handball there as well that they could have claimed for, but then Phil O'Donnell, who had a smashing game, it has to be said, just slipped it there, and the wee man rarely misses from that distance. This one was the goal of the match. Some lovely stuff here. Four or five man move, the first touch stuff, and McKinnon looks to be probably the best signing for a long time at Motherwell I've had. I mean, everything came down the left, his crossing was immaculate, and Steve Kirkley was very brave, just got in front of the defender. And look at that, there's three Motherwell players all following in. Any one of them could have scored the goal there, and that must be pleasing for wee Tam. Another good move coming through, a lovely little flick. Steve Kirk, probably the best game he's had for Motherwell for a few seasons as well. Once again, there's this man McKinnon. Three men around him, that's how dangerous he was tonight. The ball, nice stuff, nice control there by wee Dougie Arnott, but Steve Kirk, how he got this ball across from such a tight angle again, still baffles me. A little flick on, and there's Fergie's first goal of the season. Really misses them. Tremendous stuff.
I guess Rangers were having thoughts about their next round match at that stage.
Well, there's no doubt that Walter Smith and Archie Knox would be there, because that was the great incentive for the two teams tonight. That's what they were looking for, the old ticket crowd at Ibrox, a few quid in their pockets, and it was a good game.
Ayr must have been really disappointed with that first half showing. They caved in to a certain extent, but they really bounced back in the second half.
They great did, comeback. But you know, you've got to give all credit to Motherwell. They played superb first half. It's not often wee Tam was delighted with his team's performance, as he said, but they really did play well and didn't allow Ayr to play. But in the second half, Ayr threw caution to the wind. They had to. And the big fella, Ali Graham, there, you know, he's 6'2", 6'3", always a threat because of his height, and that's a smashing goal. We could have stolen another couple of goals there, United, because Motherwell did take the foot off the gas, there's no doubt about that. Ayr just threw men forward, they had to salvage something, and they did create a couple of good chances there. Billy Thompson had to be lively. Here's another one that just broke. Good ball into the box, three men there. And there he is, up on Jordi. I just didn't connect quite well with it, but by that time they were out of the cup. It was only a few minutes to go.
Can the holders have a shock for Rangers at Ibrox?
Well, they did it last year. They went to Pittodrie and they did it the hard way last year. Well, they're going to have to play well at Ibrox. That'll be some game.
You reckon Motherwell have got what it takes?
Well, if they play well and Rangers don't play well, of course they have a chance.
OK, thanks for now, Derek. Well, there was another third round replay, of course, in the Tennent Scottish Cup tonight. It was at Rugby Park and it certainly produced some drama. It was Kilmarnock against Meadowbank. We join it midway through the first half. Kilmarnock struggling to cling on to their promotion hopes in the league, looking for a cup run as well. And this is what happened with 27 minutes gone. Watch for Ian Little on the end of this, in the box, the looping header, beats Bobby Geddes, and that's Meadowbank 1-up. 18-year-old Ian Little, but he was scoring goals when he was 16, so he hasn't lost the habit. 15 minutes from time, Kilmarnock really fighting for their cup lives at this stage. And there's Hugh Burns, the former Rangers player, with the chest control. Just checking he wasn't offside, a quick glance at the far side linesman. Penalty shootout now after no goals in extra time. And that was Dave Roseborough with penalty number one. Meadowbank one up in the penalty shootout. Now Tom Black, former Airdrie St Mirren player. Well, he scored a cracker on Saturday, and that was 1-1 on penalties. Bobby Geddes on the Kilmarnock goal line. And it's Armstrong with Meadowbank second. In off the inside of the post. But that's 2-1 to the Edinburgh team. Roberts with the second for Kilmarnock. Soft one, saved by McQueen. And that was 2-1 Meadowbank at that stage. Irvine missed as well though, Bobby Geddes saved, and the scoreline stayed 2-1. That was Hugh Burns, he scored normal time, and that was his penalty, which made it 2 each. Ian Little, that's his second, 3-2. Callum Campbell, 3-all. Getting tense now, Stuart Williamson for Meadowbank. Great penalty, Bobby Geddes guessed right but couldn't stop it. And so Tommy Burns, the veteran of so many important occasions in football, had to score this to keep Kilmarnock in, saved by McQueen. And 4-3 on penalties, Kilmarnock go out. And that's Meadowbank through to a tie against Morton in the next round. And Kilmarnock, Derek, were the first victims in the Tennent Scottish Cup of a penalty shootout. So that's a second one for them, and unlucky to go out that way, obviously.
Well, they are. They knew after this round that someone had to go out, Dougie, and Tommy Burns would be one disappointed man, but that's how it goes. And Kilmarnock will be very, very disappointed as well. They're struggling now in the first division. That's them out of the cup. They're going to have to get their sleeves up now.
Don't call me Doogie if you could. But on to other Scottish results now. And Division 2, one game off today. That was Alloa against Cowdenbeath, waterlogged pitch. A last-minute winner by Doogie Scott gave Brechin a win against Stranraer. Clyde pushing for promotion. And two goals each for Steve Morrison and Frank McGarvey at Douglas Park. Rovers Jackson was sent off. Another last-minute goal gave East Stirling a draw at Methil. East Fife a point behind Clyde. And the leaders beaten, there's the big one at the bottom. Kearney's goal giving Stenhouse Muir a victory, and Dumbarton's lead is cut back to 3 points. And one other scoreline, it was a friendly match played at Parkhead this afternoon. Celtic nil, the visiting New Zealand team won. But more significant from Celtic's point of view is that Tony Mowbray, who's been injured for so long, of course, came back, played the whole game. Charlie Nicholas played a half as well, Derek. So that's obviously good news for Celtic to get Mowbray back.
Well, that's why I think the game was played for Tony Mowbray. He hasn't played for 2 or 3 weeks. You said Charlie Nick was in there. Pat Bonner played for 18 minutes. He got injured and had to come off as well. So it'd be a good exercise for a few of the fringe Celtic players.
Now, a certain meeting in Rome today decided on the timetable for Scotland's World Cup qualifiers, which start later this year. Let's have a look at those. Derek, there they are. Andy Roxburgh wanted a tough opening. He wanted the tough ones first, and he certainly had his wish granted.
Well, it's a smashing draw, and the dates are perfect, really. We're talking about playing Switzerland away. Well, we just drew there 2-2 just a wee while ago, Jurie McCoy scoring. And we'll play them in September, which is great because the players are fresh. I think that's what Andy's looking for. Then the following month against Portugal as well, the players still just starting the season, so they'll enjoy that one. The only difficult ones, and they've got away with it in May, just at the end of the season when the supposed tired legs after 44 league games again, but we'll play Estonia, and then a month later in June, Estonia again. So he's got away with it, Andy.
The SFA are clinging to the hope that Hamden will be ready for those first two games in October and November. What do you think?
Well, they're hopeful, but really, it won't all be finished. I mean, you can't have one side where there's no fans and behind the goals, yes. I think, realistically, they have to play the games at Ibrox.
And I know you're looking forward in particular to the trip to Estonia.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Where is it?
I don't know. We'll study the map after the programme. Well, now on to the English Cup, and you won't get a much more suitable name for a team of giant killers than Wrexham, because that's what the Welshmen did to the cup hopes of league champions Arsenal in the third round. And 10 days ago, there was a shock for West Ham, held to a 2-2 draw at Upton Park by the 4th Division side. Tonight's replay at the Racecourse Ground boosted Wrexham's cup takings to around £200,000. But could they go even further? We join the action early in the first half. Commentator Tony Gubba.
Mickey Thomas, he loves to hit them with that left foot as they drop. Owen, tried to take it in his stride and get past McAvenny at the same time and lost it. The decision was given by that linesman in Wrexham's favour, and Mike Small looked very puzzled. McAvenny, this is Brown, it was kept in play. Thackeray will have to do something. In fact, the linesman's given the corner, yes, it wasn't quite going to run, and Slater got there very quickly. So, just under 20 minutes gone, West Ham's first corner. Foster up. And it was from corners that Wrexham didn't defend too well in that first match, but they did all right there. Davis. As though Watkin will have to come back, he's offside. Oh, he's pushed it right through them. It's a terrific break, and he's kept his balance. That was a trip. That was a trip. Now, if the letter of the law is applied, that trip on Conley will see Tim Breaker sent off. What will Mr. Trussell do? Conley had outstripped him. There's a posse of players round there. And maybe it's a yellow card. Well, that's one to look at and debate. Breaker stays on. Wrexham have a free kick. And Mickey Thomas has had his say to the referee as well, just by the ball. Now he'll take the free kick, Mickey Thomas. But that's a controversial talking point.
chipped up beautifully. They're all forward. Oh, nearly. Owen. Well, it was a well-worked move. This is one from the training ground. A little chip up. Gareth Owen had continued his run, and he swung a leg at it and missed. Well, here's the trip. Conley. Watkin. Bit of a solitary figure up front, Steve Watkin. Flick on by Small. Here's McAvenny, West Ham's first chance, and O'Keefe has made a very good stop. Well, that'll do the 34-year-old a world of good. That's one for building confidence. McAvenny threw into the penalty area with a clear sight of goal, and O'Keefe didn't give him a sniff. Well, that's the first real chance that West Ham have made in his opening 25 minutes, and it was quickly snuffed out. Still a lot of running in the legs of Mickey Thomas. Conley. Oh, he's got outside breaker, and that's over the top for Watkin, covered by Mitchell Thomas. Potts. Easily dealt with. Mickey Thomas. Hardy. Owen. Breaker. Carey's jump. It's dropped for McAvenny. Now Slater. Oh, well done, Stuart Slater. He let Thackeray dive in. Dix on the outside. And who was it covering? Gareth Owen. Small. Dix. Oh, it was a trip, but he kept his feet, Slater. And Mickey Thomas concedes the corner. Again, Mitchell Thomas is prominent, so too is Foster. That's Foster! And he's there, the big man. Colin Foster, tallest figure in that penalty area, has put West Ham ahead against the run of play, it has to be said, after 27 minutes. And yet again, Wrexham have conceded a goal from a corner. Well, there was no defender jumping with him, it was only O'Keefe the keeper. It looped in over the top of Thackeray. And yet again, Wrexham have gone behind in an FA Cup tie. They trailed to Arsenal, remember, before they came back to win 2-1. They trailed twice to West Ham before they got it back to 2-2. And now a goal down against the run of play. Potts with the tackle. Just under the crossbar. But it's a cruel blow to Wrexham. And now it's another test of character. Conley. Oh, Mitchell Thomas let it run, and he was almost caught out because it didn't go out of play. Mickey Thomas still wants to hit it first time, left footed. Well, former Manchester United, Everton and Chelsea player, once an FA Cup finalist and runner up back in 1979 when he was with Manchester United. Foster's headers, only down to Conley. Carey! Oh, he took it well, Brian Carey. It was a half chance that broke to him, but he got a lot of meat into it. First shot across the face of goal was by Carl Conley, and when it ricochets out to Brian Carey, he struck it well. Satori. Oh, he's only succeeded in giving it to McAvenny. and has to concede the throw. Keane back to Slater as the whistle goes to end the first half, which is disappointing from Wrexham's point of view because they had the better of the chances in the first 25 minutes. But it was Colin Foster who put West Ham ahead somewhat against the run of play with that header from the corner after 27. And since then, a little of the Welsh fire has died and it will need to be rekindled in the dressing room at half-time. Here at the racecourse ground, it's Wrexham 0, West Ham 1. Well, West Ham haven't reached the fifth round of the FA Cup yet. Remember, Wrexham were trailing in both the games against Arsenal and in the first match at Upton Park and scored all their goals in the second. And Tony Parks might yet have a busy 45 minutes. Conley back to Hardy, forced to hurry by Small, who handled, and free kick which has already been taken. Conley, Mickey Thomas, Gordon Davis. Well, if Wrexham make a start to the second half anything like the one they made to the first, then this game could quickly be turned around. Here's Watkin, he's taken it off Dix. Oh, Dix recovered well. Just for a minute, Dix was in trouble, but he did really well, the number three. And Slater to put McAvaney away. Nobody in the middle to look for. And he's tripped from behind by Carey. Free kick. Well, the one thing Wrexham don't want to do, of course, is concede a second goal. But Watkin was so quick to take that off Dix, who then in response did well himself. Brown, back to Keane. Foster stayed forward. Slater. It was a diving tackle by Thackeray. Foster's coming in. Header out was by Carey. This is Phillips. Not what he intended, I'm sure. Well, Wrexham have won all their home FA Cup ties. They're going to have to come from behind again if they're to do the same to West Ham that they did to Arsenal. He's there again! Oh, well, unless they pick him up and unless they deal with him from corners, Wrexham are not going to find a way back. He got to that and just directed it wide. Hardy again. Gordon Davis to chase, and he's got it. Well done, Gordon Davis. This is Thackeray. This is Owen. Oh, it was drilled across. Now, was he looking for a head? Was he looking at the target? He's really pumped up and down this field, Gareth Owen. Attacker 1 minute, defender the next, and he thumped that right across goal. And in the end, it wasn't too far wide. Oh, what an invitation to head if somebody had been coming in. Mickey Thomas. He wants an inspired ball from somebody. And that wasn't it. But that's Wrexham's throw. They've got to keep the pressure on, they've got to keep West Ham unsettled, and they've got to increase the pressure as we move into the last 20 minutes. So Trevor Morley on and Mike Small off, and you'd have to say that the decision to play Mike Small from the start hasn't really been a great success for West Ham. Oh, Mike Small! Owen! He did everything right, and it needed a fine stop from Parks. And that's what Wrexham want. They just want one half chance like that. was always close enough for the keeper not to be in serious trouble. Morley. Phillips. Back to Thackeray. To Watkin, who took it down very well. Now this is the boy, Lee Jones. Faced by Potts. Left foot cross. Header out only as far as Hardy. Mickey Thomas left it. Conley! He's got it across goal, and it was behind three of them. What a pity. Well, that was another chance like the ones that Wrexham got in the first half, and they didn't manage to score then. And that was a good opportunity. It was a neat bit of football. They really had the pressure on. But when that ball came across, it was right on the penalty spot, and the three red shirts had been sucked in closer. Mickey Thomas. This is Lee Jones. Good tackle by Potts, but still in play. Conley. There's a lot forward. Flick on, Owen! Oh, it didn't quite drop. Andy Thackeray was up as well. Owen was just ahead of him. And again, it didn't quite come off for them. This is Thackeray. They've got to leave everybody forward and just make sure nobody gets offside, and nobody did. But the ball wasn't very good. Well, Colin Trussell, the referee, did admonish one or two West Ham players midway through the second half that they were time-wasting, and indicated that he would add time on. In fact, he booked McAvenny for time-wasting. And we're now approaching a minute of stoppage time. Jones tussling and back on his feet. Owen wants it. Here he is, but look how quickly Dix closed him down and got in the tackle. Hardy. There's perhaps time just for one more effort. Oh. Morley for West Ham. Keane. They just want to play it into the corners now, West Ham. Back to the keeper will do. Referee's looked at his watch, and it looks as though Wrexham's romance with this season's FA Cup is about to come to an end. But if it does, and surely there isn't time left for them now to get back against West Ham, what a gloss, what a shine, what a smile they've put on the face of this season's competition. Being dramatically beaten the champions Arsenal in the third round here 2-1. And then twice come back to draw 2-2 against West Ham in the first match. And if they are to lose this, there may be one or two who look back and say there were moments of controversy in the first half when the whole shape of this game may have been different. If Tim Breaker had gone for what looked like a blatant professional foul on Carl Connolly, West Ham would have had to play for the lion's share of the match with only 10 men. And relief will surely light up the face of Billy Bonds. Mickey Thomas. That came off the defender. Wrexham's throw. And Mr. Trussell is being as good as his word. He's added quite a lot of time. Conley. Mickey Thomas. Oh, the header was by Watkin. And it went behind for a goal kick. Well, Wrexham have given us some new names to think about. Steve Watkin is one of them. He's only 20 years of age. Phil Hardy, the left back's another. As the whistle goes, and the dream is snuffed out by a goal from Colin Foster, scored after 27 minutes, and Billy Bonds will be mightily relieved that West Ham have gone through.
Well, brave old Wrexham, but it's West Ham who go through to the fifth round of the Cup in England. Elsewhere, Notts County winners against Kenny Dalglish's Blackburn, and former Scotland striker David Speedy sent off in that game, along with county captain Phil Turner. And a shock for First Division Sheffield Wednesday, beaten by second division Middlesbrough, John Hendry and Paul Wilkinson got the Borough goals. Division 2, Portsmouth 4, Plymouth 1, Swindon 2, Bristol City 0. Duncan Shearer, the former Highland League player, scored one of those goals, 28 for the season for him. Northampton 1, Aldershot 0 in Division 4. There is the fifth round draw in the Cup. Derek, what do you fancy there?
Smashing draw, isn't it, really? You've got to look at Ipswich against Liverpool or Bristol Rovers. Chelsea, that's the team. I think they could maybe shock a few then there. Let's hope they get to the final.
And a bit disappointed for Wrexham and your old mate Brian Flynn?
There is. I phoned him up this morning to wish him all the best, so I'm a jinx, haven't I? I mean, obviously, the turning point is the decision. Was it Tim Breaker, the foul? I mean, he should have been off the park.
It certainly looked like it, didn't it? Must remind myself not to take a phone call from you in the morning, wishing me well. Sports Scene tomorrow night returns with more Cup action from the Tennant Scottish Cup and also from the English Cup, plus a preview of the Winter Olympics. And that's at 10:30, the earlier time of 10:30, BBC Scotland on One. Including Master Snooker, of course, which is what we go to next, the Benson & Hedges Masters at Wembley Conference Centre. This is a second round match between Dennis Taylor and Steve Davis, best of nine frames. Taylor won the first. We join it in the second. It's 35-26. Commentators Ray Edmonds and Clive Everton.
10. Sixteen.
So, Davis needs a snooker.
28.
And I don't think he's going to get the chance to play for one.
30.
And the way Taylor's played in these opening two frames, Davis has got a real battle on his hands.
33.
Davis has won tournaments in Antwerp, Bournemouth and Bangkok in the last 6 weeks. Tonight he's been outplayed so far.
37.
Dennis Taylor leads Steve Davis by 2 frames to 0.
Well, it was a splendid start for him. At the interval, he still had that 2 frames lead. He led 3-1. We pick it up now, and he's still got a 2 frames lead. It's 4-2 to Taylor, and he's got 1 point on the board in the 7th frame.
1.
Well, it's too good a shot. The angle on the yellow didn't look possible to get the cue ball there.
Three, Dennis Taylor. One
out of the blue there.
John Street is using his plastic thing there to...
Eight.
..measure whether the ball would start. Obviously it doesn't.
Nine.
And there's a few balls 16. Available here.
Seventeen. Thirty.
Well, should be able to run through off the reds onto the black, but shot with a bit of fine judgment, no problem.
31.
And it nudged two others out, so perhaps a fair few more points to come for Steve Davis.
38.
I wonder what his thoughts are at the moment. He's got to get over the winning post.
46. Forty-seven. 54. 55. Nine. 60.
Just the pink required to virtually put the frame safe, but there's still one or two more points left there for Steve yet.
66. 77 74 75 82 83 89 90.
There's £10,000 at stake for the highest break of these Masters. That high break at the moment is in the hands
96.
Of the...
96.
In the hands of the young Typhoon, James Watanar, a break of 130.
98.
Steve, unable to get that far.
101.
He's made the second century.
101.
It's pulled one frame back for him. He's now one frame adrift at 3 frames to four.
Well, a break of 50, one frame eight for Davis. That made it 4-4. So here now is the deciding frame.
Dennis Taylor to break.
So it's Dennis Taylor breaking off for the ninth and final frame of this match. A big crowd here at Wembley Conference Centre, enthralled with the play. Dennis having played brilliantly at the beginning. There's a picture of the Conference Centre. 2,700 comfortable seats.
One.
Two faces there of concentration.
8.
Steve, who has fought back 8. So brilliantly.
9. Sixteen. 17.
The first 3 reds and a black with each.
24. 25.
Gives himself an angle to break the pack if he so wishes.
Yes,
I don't think he meant to touch the pack there, Ted. I thought he may well have got into the pack, but there was the loose one out. But just catching the reds has run the cue ball out of position. If he takes the red on to the right corner, cue ball looks sure to go into the pink or the other reds.
Biting his nails.
And
they're all thrilled with that one.
Steve Davis. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
The audience becoming over-enthusiastic now. The tension rising.
Thanks, Steve. It's been perhaps a little fortunate not to have left Dennis a much easier red to start with.
And of course, Ray, Dennis has been sat in his chair quite a bit over the last two frames.
Well, it doesn't help, Ted, and apart from that, I think he's got to put out of his mind the fact that he has had chances to win this match. They're all in the past now.
Still undecided. Now, can he get the cue ball amongst the reds? No, I don't think he's got anything, and Steve looks up.
for Dennis Taylor.
Snooker can be such an agonizing game to play at times. Dennis at the moment, feeling that agony.
Just left Steve one half chance of taking the cue ball round the back of the black. And one great safety shot produces another.
One.
Well, I think that was the only possible ball that would putt. A little trickle here.
One. Steve Davis.
He's 30 points ahead now.
I think he might have a path off the right-hand side, Ted, just to slide past the black, perhaps, and drop on the back cushion, or possibly go a bit steeper and drop on the one near the left-hand side cushion.
Is it going to reach?
Well, four. And a miss. Steve Davis.
Steve has a look and asks referee John Street to replace the cue ball.
Bow four, Steve Davis.
Yes, that time there was enough pace, but not quite the right angle. Half a chance left for Steve Davis.
will you have a bash at this? I think he's got away with that.
Touching ball.
And there's some young people who should be in bed. But my word, they're thoroughly enjoying this game. A bowed head there from Dennis. The normally smiling Irish eyes there, sharing a little anguish.
Dennis would dearly love to take the one on down the right-hand side, but could be in trouble if he misses this one. I really don't think it was the shot to take on, but was in a bit of trouble.
Yes, I wonder what his thoughts are now. He's wanted the winning frame for the last three frames. 38 points the lead as Steve comes to the table. Still looking so cool there.
One.
Well, now will he take on the black? The answer,
Ramble?
Definite no.
One, Steve Davis.
Not the time to take chances, Ray.
So often in this match, Steve Davis has found just about the most awkward spot to drop the cue ball.
more nail biting going on there.
Foul, four, and a miss. Steve Davis.
Dennis has already marked the spot where the cue ball should go.
Right there.
Still that sense of humour.
As you can see, Steve can hit that red to pot it, but don't know where he's going to go with the cue ball. Yes, just making sure of taking the odd red.
One.
He's got a 44-point lead. And Dennis is... think's going to be in trouble again after this shot.
And of course, Ray, every red that Steve takes is 8 points less that Dennis can get.
One, Steve Davis.
Green, brown and blue now, safely on cushions.
One. Foul. One. Steve Davis. Five. Dennis Taylor. Free ball.
Well, would you believe that, Ted?
Well, that's quite extraordinary.
A succession of near perfect shots from Steve Davis, and then he just must have had a little bit of tension in his arm and misjudged it, and now he's in trouble of his own making.
Thinking that wasn't the red that Steve was going for, but nevertheless he got out of the trouble.
One.
that sip of water which was come almost his trademark. Oh, I say.
One, Dennis Taylor.
But that really is unbelievable, Ray, isn't it?
Well, it can only, as I say, Ted, be tension. Just couldn't let the cue go through. And it looks as if it's catching, Ted. Well.
Amazing. With Dennis Taylor then, another chance. 39 points behind. There's a possible 59 points on the table. We've seen some epic battles between these two stars. None more so, of course, than the 1985 World Final.
One. Eight. Nine.
Yes, just twixt and between. Neither straight for the middle nor straight for the corner.
He's staring at that black as he put it too near the cushion. The scene of battle.
Not absolutely necessary for Dennis to take the black on. He doesn't really need the 7 points. They would be useful, but he might just drop the cue ball behind it.
Black ball. 17, Dennis Taylor.
Well, he did as you told him, Ray. Does that sip of water keep him cool?
One.
The last red disappears.
a wry smile because Dennis hasn't brought the cue ball down far enough to make it easy to get back towards the yellow.
Has he snookered himself?
8.
14 points separating them.
Eight, Dennis Taylor.
And I think he can pot that green.
Five.
Steve wants one ball.
Well, I think he'll have a go at this one, Ted. Blue is safe. Every chance that the brown would wobble and go safe should he miss it. So I think he'll take it on.
Five, Steve Davis.
Tennis requires the four colours. That's a pretty tall order. I think he looked to the heavens there for inspiration. Applause, but it's not quite there. It's a nasty one, too. The center pocket's in the way. Oh, where's the cue ball going?
I think he deserved that bit of luck there, Ted.
Yes, I'd agree. Silent.
tremendous shot. To get the thinnest contact. Any thicker and the brown would have been over the corner pocket. Now then, could easily have left Dennis a pot, but he's left him a good chance of the snooker behind the black.
Can be very useful.
Yes, I just saw the look on Dennis's face, and I think Steve can get past the black. That expression would suggest so, but it's a difficult pot.
He's right underneath that top cushion.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Still 19 points the difference with 22 points on the table. Hampered by the pink.
Take on the pot. And the way that colours are situated, it